CPC meeting. First up on the agenda is the request for minor site plan review, 600-622 Main Street, MF Charles Building, upper floors. Jesse, not sure if there's anything you want to sort of kick us off?
Sure. The applicant is here, but basically they are back for the second and third floor. The plan is to fit out both for commercial use. The second floor is going to be used by Northern Bank and Trust. The second floor, they're seeking at this point just approval for a sort of a vanilla box for them, a future tenant can come in and do their individual fit out. They do plan on having additional rooftop units, and we did get a plan this afternoon, so I have that and look at as well. But I'll let Sean go into the details of the proposal.
Steve, thanks for having us again. For the record, Attorney Strawberry here, law firm of Mon & Mon, 275 Mishawaka Road, Woburn. Appearing before you, as always, on behalf of Haven Properties, LLC, the owner of the MF Charles Building. I have with me Jim Mon of Haven Properties here this evening. Before the board this evening is a request for minor site plan review under section 4.6.3 of the Reading Zoning Bylaw. As Jesse mentioned, it's for the interior build-out of the second and the third floor. The construction proposed here is exclusively interior. There is no exterior construction proposed. The second floor is an interior build-out to accommodate a single commercial tenant, which will be Northern Bank and Trust Company. The third floor, again, as Jesse mentioned, is an interior build-out to accommodate up to two commercial office tenants. Right now, it's proposed as just a vanilla box, kind of running some services into some general spaces. In terms of parking, commercial use, it's exempt from section 9.1, located within 300 feet of a public off-street parking facility. Northern has currently purchased 5 off-street parking spaces from the Knights of Columbus and continues to pursue other options for some off-street employee parking, and happy to keep you updated on those efforts. There's no signage proposed currently with this application. Second floor tenant is again Northern Bank. I think there's plenty of signage indicating that tenant currently. Future third floor tenants will submit their own signage applications, and they'll have to be consistent with the Reading Zoning Bylaw and the master signage plans for the property. In terms of trash removal, the second floor tenant will utilize existing accommodations already provided for Northern Bank, which is ample. Third floor tenants, once identified, can require a further update to the trash plan. Again, they're office tenants, so it'll be pretty light trash use anyway, but we're happy to provide an update to the trash plan once those tenants have been identified. And as Jesse mentioned, we did receive today proposed roof plan showing the approximate locations of two additional rooftop units. Again, those are kind of approximate at this point, but they'll definitely be 10 feet back from the roof edge, similar to the existing units there, and happy to paint them a consistent color with what's up there now, as previously recommended by the Reading Historical Commission. So overall, again, a fairly straightforward proposal here, strictly interior build out and two office tenants on the second and third floor, or up to two on the third floor, I should say. Office use on both.
And you said the Reading Historical Commission, I think I saw on the meeting notes, they don't have any objections to anything, just want any rooftop units painted black.
Yeah, they were at the DRT, and the since there's really no exterior improvements other than that, they have no comments on the project, and just recommend that the units be screened if approved by painting them black.
Okay. Good. Any questions or comments from the board?
No.
Yeah, that's pretty straightforward. We knew you were coming back, and
we try to make it straightforward.
Signage with the thank yous doesn't change, correct?
Correct.
That what I understood?
Third floor tenants, there could be somebody other than Northern Bank that could come back on their own. And briefly discuss this with Jesse, but whatever they do propose, obviously, would have to be consistent with the bylaw. And again, we do have the master signage plan in place for the property, so.
The two things that would be impactful would be parking and trash, and it sounds like you you're working to address both of those.
Yeah, I mean, the parking is in the best interest of the bank to provide some employee parking. They're actively searching for more parking. They bought everything that they could get their hands on at the moment,
yeah.
And they'll continue to seek additional parking.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Jean.
Yeah, hi, Jean Delios. I was just curious, how many employees would you anticipate?
In that space, that department right now has 15 employees, but that can change depending on market stresses.
So I saw as laid out, do you have enough space here if it was jam-packed? If every seat was filled, that there would be 25, the way it's laid out.
Yeah, I think they
counted.
Observation, yeah.
So this can accommodate 25 employees. Is that, am I understanding that correctly?
Potentially. There's 15 in that department now.
Sure,
but
sure.
Ask for a layout that could show expansion of that department. There is none anticipated at this point, but we wanted to see what that floor can handle.
Yeah, definitely.
I would imagine 25 people in that space would probably be pretty cozy.
The 7,000 square foot floor plate. You know, I think you can see boiler rooms that have a lot more than that type of density, but I don't expect it's going to reach that level anyway.
And one would expect that the is the upper floor the same floor plate?
It is.
7,000 square feet.
7,000 square feet with the same
opportunity. Yeah.
Yeah. Same opportunity. There.
It is.
The only difference there is that there'd have to be some common corridors that would
right.
take up
yeah.
the availability for
yeah.
for desk space.
All right. Any questions or comments from anyone in the audience? Yes, sir.
David O'Sullivan, O'Sullivan Architects. We're presently at 580 Main Street, and we're kind of in negotiation with Jim to move our offices from 580 up to the third floor, talking about taking some around half of it or so. And hopefully part of it, this is the first step, but we've kind of been discussing it, negotiating, we're close to coming up with something. And so we want to move across the street. We've had a lot of trouble trying to find space in town that's big enough for us.
Oh, good, okay.
And we've been in town 6 years above Bank of America. So
sure.
The idea would be to move hopefully to the third floor.
So that means you're growing?
Yes. Well, we have 10 people. When we moved in there, we had 6. And we're trying to take enough space so we could have a couple more beyond that. So yeah.
Excellent.
Perfect.
You know, as to parking for us, we actually have 10 people and 5 are residents of town, so they park resident stickers. And we purchased the town employee stickers and had no trouble with that for people. So we're not concerned over parking for our own use, because we've been dealing with it. We don't have any parking where we are now. So, you know.
That's great. Excellent.
Mm-hmm.
Want to turn our attention to the decision? See if there's any changes. Jesse, did you make any updates? I'm looking at the copy that was in my packet that was mailed to my house.
The only thing I changed on this was added the floor plan. The route plan, excuse me. We do have.
Okay. Looks like you've got 2 areas of question, one around the mechanical units and one around fit out by the identified tenants.
Administrative approval at most, I think, for the subsequent fit-out.
Right. That, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
So for number 3, you want administrative approval for the fit-outs for the upper third floor?
Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah.
When
businesses come in for fit-outs of space, if it's the same use, we don't get involved.
Right.
And I would just assume that that administrative approval includes, as you mentioned, the update to the trash plan is really the big piece, and then whatever signage. The signage, I think, well, if there's a master signage plan, then we don't need to see that either.
Wow.
Right.
That master signage plan
contemplated upper
levels.
Yeah.
We haven't had any signs for 6 years. The procedure we have done previously was when they submitted their application for signage to the town, it came along with a letter from the landlord saying that it had been
right.
approved under the master signage plan. We've had an opportunity to see it. I would envision the same process.
But I think the difference, as Gene alluded to, is that I think the master signage plan contemplated just the first floor, and since you didn't know what was going on up the second and third
yeah.
floors, I'm not sure that you incorporated that. So
we can take a look at it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, there's probably a menu board kind of, you know.
It will run into the same issues that we talked about last month across the alleyway, where on the building.
No, I was thinking about, I mean, just the interior. I mean, there'd be the building directory kind of thing.
If the master signage plan doesn't contemplate the second and third floor, you could leave it to say it just has to comply with the running zoning bylaw.
Yeah.
Okay.
To make a determination whether or not we want to have the master signage plan updated and if there's.
Yeah, I mean, I think the majority of the space is ample signage already, and as far as the two third floor tenants are concerned, I think it's going to be mostly directories and perhaps some window signage on the doors.
Okay. Yeah, so you guys decide if you want to amend it. If not, no, I think that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
Appreciate the flexibility.
Yeah, sure. That means that you may not have to come before us again, which is
never say no.
Remarkable. Yes. That's our goal, though, right? How do we want to account for the mechanical units?
So I've added just a finding. Rooftop units are proposed as depicted in sheet A31. And then conditioned it prior to the issuance of a building permit that they shall submit a revised roof plan identifying any additional mechanical units for the new proposed uses. I did that twice, so I think we can, the plan should identify the preferred method of screening used to be painted black by the historical commission.
So with that, just if I'm understanding it correctly, if the final plan should just indicate that we intend to paint them black.
Yep.
You said you got the roof plan, Jessica?
Yeah, that is here. So we have some existing units here.
Yeah,
and
see
new
one. There are two proposed new units there and two new exhaust pipes proposed. And it looks like a new hatch as well. But at this point, those locations are approximate based on the comments from the architect.
And what's the roof hatch made out of?
Good question. I honestly don't know. Bill code type, I'd have to get a.
Okay.
That's usually a metal one that's top of about 30 inches or something.
I can find that.
Okay. That'd be helpful to know just when we get to that point. Whatever detail you have on it.
Condition number 7, do we need to refine that a little bit to make it specific to third floor? Or does it apply to second floor tenants as well, or the second floor tenant?
Existing trash plan does not account for second and third floor.
Oh, okay.
I'm submitting that since the second floor tenant is Northern Bank, they can utilize the existing trash accommodations for Northern Bank, which just makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, okay.
It's not a problem to make a revision to the trash accommodate both of them.
Okay.
Okay.
That will just need to address the update to Bunratty now that we know, I'm assuming that you know who their vendor is. I think in the last plan it was TBD. So any updates to that chart?
I think that was December of last year, so we didn't know at that point.
Yep, so any updates to that?
Okay, so we're all set?
I believe so.
When do you think you'd be coming in for the building permit?
It's pretty close on the plans, so.
Tomorrow?
Tomorrow. As soon as possible.
Move that the CPDC approve the minor site plan review for the proposed modifications at the appropriate location. 622 Main Street, as amended.
Second.
All those in favor?
Okay.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for putting us first.
I was gonna say, remember last time? It was like 11:30.
Just hang out in the back.
12 o'clock at night.
Through the cloud.
Was that the library or was it Criterion?
How many?
Never was. It was late. Thanks, folks. Have a good one. All right. Next up on the agenda, an update on open space zoning, natural resource zoning. I think this is a follow-on to the conversation we had last time around PRD, PUD.
Yeah, so I know the last meeting we talked about sort of taking a step back and really thinking about how we want to tackle our PRD zoning, because a lot of the changes that George had made, it almost made it sound like we just need to rewrite the whole thing or really sort of think about it more comprehensively than just revising what we have. So Gina and I thought it, you know, maybe a good place to start would be to sort of take a look at our peer communities that we have. So in your packets, we had our summer intern take a look and sort of just collect the bylaws from our peer communities that have this type of zoning, and then a few other examples, the backlot zoning and a few other cluster examples from our non-peer communities, just to sort of see what's out there. So no analysis has really been done. We haven't delved into it in too much detail. I took a pretty quick look at some of these and saw that there's some similarities between them, but they're also pretty different too. Processes that they go about are widely different. But in general, it seems that, you know, everybody follows that base density. You know, what's allowed in the underlying district is what would be allowed by this cluster. You just are, but you know, required to cluster it and preserve the open space and resources. With the exception of North Reading, the only one I saw, I think, really sort of allowed an increase in density. I think it's 1.2 above the base zoning. So that's sort of all that we've gotten to at this point. So I don't know how much you guys were able to read through over the weekend, but
yeah. Not a whole lot, frankly. Can you? Well, go ahead. I'm sorry.
I had a chance while I was waiting for a software build to go through a fair amount of the stuff online. And some of the things that struck me is that they're generally talking about large,
very large parcels.
You know, anywhere from, you know, 120,000 square foot minimum and up to like 10 acres.
Yeah.
Which in our case has usually fallen into the PUD rather than the PRD kind of thing. Some number of them are very well written, and I was, if I can remember, the things that stood out.
Most of them seem to be by special permit, and they specify the district. And sometimes the density or what was allowed varied by the district, but I didn't really see any of them that required sort of the overlay first or the town meeting action first and then the special permit. It was always, you can have a special permit if it's in these defined districts.
Right.
and you have to meet obviously the criteria.
Which takes that whole sort of dual process that we have that seems, at least to me, pretty onerous.
Yeah.
How you get to the same place, but you take that that two-step process out.
Yeah, there's also, there were one or two of them that I read through quickly had specific features. And it says, if you do this, then you get a 0.2, you know, extra in the density and so on and so forth. I mean, that was an interesting trading token approach to things.
Well, that's what I started to question is why, what's the benefit of a developer choosing cluster zoning versus traditional subdivision control? I mean, other than they could possibly not have to install an entire road.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, other than that, they don't get any density bonuses or anything like that. In some respects, it almost seems more challenging to do this.
Well, I guess I read through, skimmed through, I should say, skimmed through these as well and came up with the same conclusion that you did, David, that a lot of these are tailored to big developments and developers. And I started gravitating towards the other community examples,
right,
which are really more, seem to be more focused on backlot zoning. Like especially the Brookline one, and I don't think that that's really where we are going, because that adds a whole level of density, and I think they didn't have that same thing in terms of like you can't add more density. Their part was adding density, but it started getting me thinking that really the thing that I heard from you all and that we see from time to time is that we have these in town, there are these long, thin parcels with property in the back that isn't useful because the frontage is just not there, the potential is there for those properties to get combined so that you could have a developable parcel out there if neighbors were to cooperate and do that, and not really increasing the density of the town, but just making it a little bit more develop nicely, you know, instead of rows of houses all set back.
Well, it's infill. I mean, because basically the town is
right,
is fairly well
right
utilized, if you will.
And a lot of these are not for infill. These are for greenfield, and that's not where we're at.
Yeah, the larger projects.
Yeah.
The long skinny lots, which I guess was historical occurrences. I'm not sure when or where or why they happened. I mean, they're specific locales up in the northwest corner, if you will, northwest quadrant. I mean, this. Other than allowing people to take advantage of their properties, you know, one of the things that in some cases what you want is a road running down the property line in the back so that you can split them front and back. But I'm not sure that there's anything that we should do to encourage or necessarily improve that opportunity.
Did we get anything from the consultant on cluster bylaws or any sort of proposal, rewrite, research?
Just, I think in the diagnostic he mentioned it needed work, and then when we got to that section in the ZAC review, I had provided sort of the best practice, the toolkit, the smart growth toolkit guidance, but we really didn't get into it.
I personally think that we need to provide some way that folks can use their property, or they're not restricted to the you know, all the frontage requirements, everything as it's laid out in typical subdivision rules. I get a sense that is that like we had, I forget what street that is, but up by the water tower, they found a way to use 40B and come in anyway. So I would think that we'd be better to have some way that can be flexible, and that we are in control instead of a property owner turning to 40B and saying, well, I can't build two nice houses on here. I'm going to build five
not so nice
houses and jam them in here because I can do it under 40B, but I can't do, you know, what I want under typical subdivision. And that's where I'm coming from.
Yeah, well, this is good. I mean, we're starting to get an idea of what we want to see and how we want to implement it. Town meeting approval, I feel like, would discourage this sort of creative zoning, and maybe that's a direction we want to go. I'm just trying to think through the criteria we need to outline and come to agreement on.
Well, I mean, for North Reading, I saw that they actually have both. They have a cluster bylaw for, I think it was six or more houses, certain criteria for six or more,
right.
Certain criteria for less than six. And then they also had backland development or something, some form of that as well. So
yeah.
Maybe it's that we actually need to still work on the PRD if we want to create something that's maybe for, you know, the smaller subdivisions where it's, you know, maybe it is three or four houses, and then keep this option back in zoning.
It's not a bad idea.
Or, I mean, the other option is, you know, maybe I think you've seen some minor subdivisions or, you know, some form where it's like a different subdivision process, and then use that for three, four lot subdivisions, and then just scrap the PRD altogether and just have this as another option, this backland.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, zoning. I mean, my first and enduring choice would be to just remove the current PRD. Just do away with it. And then continue to work on, you know, some possible alternative. The back lot or the back land kind of zoning was very intriguing. I'm not sure how it would play here in Reading. I mean, as I say, the areas where we have the most, what you want to call incentive, is a small number.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it's actually, maybe a dozen lots. And that's perfectly, you know, perfectly reasonable to have some kind of special permit alternative. But the current PRD is heavyweight and unwieldy and inappropriate, I think.
Yeah, I know there's certain controls, like I was, you know, skimming through the backland, back lot development. There's certain controls in place to sort of prevent every single lot from doing it. So,
right.
You know, there
yeah.
are controls.
Yes.
I know Nick had mentioned, you know, you can really change the character of the street line if you're having so many driveway cuts. But with this option, too, you're actually putting the house further back, so it's not appearing to be as dense. But there are those controls that can be in place to sort of try and absorb the character impact.
I mean, I grew up in a house with a shared driveway. I mean,
I don't think it's uncommon, but
The other thing is a lot of the back halves of properties in Reading, it's so wet. That's really why a lot of, you know, and so you'd really have to put together a whole number of properties to get enough dry land to be able to meet some of those, some of the developable
criteria.
A lot of these are.
Yeah.
I mean.
But it's, you know, it's properties like the.
Right there.
Look at that.
Oh yeah.
Look at that.
Oh, didn't we already? We talked about those.
What
actually,
is that?
Someone, right when he came in and developed that property, that was a whole discussion about those, the back halves of those properties, they wanted access back in there.
Yeah, this was Bethune.
Right.
Yes.
Got a good memory.
But under subdivision, there was nothing. He was actually, if I remember correctly, he wasn't opposed to entertaining the thought. But under subdivision, there's really no way to do that without extending that street back in there and get another developable parcel.
So how can we move this forward? Is it that we spend time reviewing all of this material that's been provided to us? Do we start to jot down our thoughts on what we would like to see as individual members of this board, and then begin to brainstorm or kind of review them together? And
yeah, I think that might be helpful, sort of picking out pieces of each one that you like, that you don't like, and you know, sort of, you know, then deciding, you know, I think at that point you'll have a better idea on whether or not PRD should stay, should go, should be something else, should we think about this backland idea, or, you know, it's really not a good idea, you know.
Are there, you mentioned like minor subdivisions, are there other
yeah, I think I saw it in here somewhere.
Yeah, are there other ways to get to sort of alternative ways of development, so that every developer isn't building a three, four property cul-de-sac, and it's just cul-de-sacs everywhere.
We can do some research.
If there's any, and you know, I'm not saying go then download everything like you've done here, but just are there some other mechanisms that get to that same same way to develop, just a little bit different.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I would think it's probably going to be more along the subdivision rules side, and we can maybe see what other communities do for like the minor subdivisions or you know, more flexible subdivisions.
Yeah,
because that, I think that's the, I mean, these are, a lot of these are the big,
right,
you know, there, I think there would be pieces we could pick out, but it may be more, we may be looking more for just different ways to do subdivisions.
Mm-hmm.
But I know that's in a whole different part of the enabling.
Well, the question that comes to my mind is, do we want, for example, for the November town meeting, to remove the existing PRD?
I'm almost wondering is if this board sort of had, you know, a better idea on what the options are, and we have the Turning Point technology. We could whole town meeting on some of these topics.
We should plan to do that.
The only comment I'd make on that is, I think it's difficult to throw a question out there at a town meeting if they're coming into it cold.
Right.
It's kind of, I feel like there needs to be a step before you get to that point. And maybe it's another public forum at some point.
Sure.
We're really maxed out for November town meeting. It's actually, the warrant closes in about, middle of September.
Yeah.
Yeah, September 14th, so it closes super early this year because the 22nd is Jewish holiday. So normally we close around the 24th, 22nd, something like that. So I don't think there's enough time to get this before town meeting. And I'm not sure we could do a good enough job explaining it and then asking people for their opinion by November. I know I couldn't.
Maybe it's just that we give them a heads up. You know, I know last time you did an update on the zoning project. Maybe with that, give sort of another update where you stand.
Yeah.
And say that we're looking into the PRD, and maybe at annual town meeting is when the poll.
Yeah.
Sure.
But
if we, if the process was to just get rid of PRD first and then to sort of work on some alternative, smaller subdivision, smaller zoning type of thing, in all of George's work, didn't he identify like a gap that was between what it, the PUD can be up to for a certain size property, but there's a gap below that. So if we were to go that way, we need to make sure that we're not creating a gap where people just can't do anything
mm-hmm.
on a certain size of property.
Right. That's the.
But I like the idea of just wiping that out so that it's not like we're trying to modify
yeah.
one and put in the other,
sure.
compare the two, because I do think it's there.
Well, it's unrealistic
mm-hmm.
between now and then. I mean, it's to come up with a new proposal. But
oh, yeah, I wasn't saying about four
okay.
for
right.
that meeting. I'm just the process going
mm-hmm.
forward.
Right.
You know, my thought was that basically removing the existing PRD would simplify, you know, clearly, but also avoid confusion. You know, because we have the POD, we have examples, we know how that works. And every time somebody has approached the PRD, they've sort of bounced off of it. So simplify.
Is there that risk though that, is there a risk there that for the period between removing the PRD and when we do introduce a new section, what kind of projects could come forward? Yeah. What does your crystal ball say? But I just wonder if it's
crystal
safer
ball
to keep
says
it.
That the PRD is unused and
the chances are very slim.
Unusable.
Right.
Yeah, we would just have to really take a look at the PUD and see what those development thresholds are and see where this lines up with it.
I mean, unless the Great Cedar Swamp dries up suddenly, you know, we don't have a place to do a PRD.
Right.
My understanding that there could be a PRD in the pipeline. Harold Ave and Van Norden. There's something before the Zoning Board of Appeals now to subdivide the lot building for them August 7th, I believe.
Oh, yeah.
It's a small street. It's one of
this
those
one.
Little ones.
Mm-hmm. There it is.
So Harold Ave actually is a PRD, a portion of it.
Yeah, this one is not part of that PRD.
So
I think it, yeah, I think it's
be this lot, I think
so.
Which is actually this entire thing.
Yes,
but
that's the one.
That's weird.
Yeah.
Is that, a driveway?
This is one lot, so they actually have an access to it from this way. I don't think that's that. I don't think they really use it that way. They have a driveway. They have
do they? Where
I think
is
so.
It?
Mm. I don't think it's showing here, but I think they do.
You do that here.
That's the driveway.
For the house, yeah.
For the house, yeah.
Yeah, and then Harold Ave is further up.
Oh, okay.
Mm. Yeah. That's Harold Ave.
Hmm.
So the plan being right is, or the intent would be to cover this, right?
Mm-hmm.
And use this.
Okay. Interesting.
What would really be interesting, actually, is if you have information about when people tried to use a PRD. Like, first of all, what PRDs, what was put through in town using a PRD, maybe what was brought forward, or even what was discussed, like if you had DRTs for
mm-hmm.
certain properties that were PRTs and then just didn't go forward. So at least we'd understand what people are trying to do and whether those are things we want to encourage or not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just a little description of how it's been used.
Yeah. Understand whether it's the process that's the reason why it's not used, or whether it's the projects just aren't really good projects.
Yeah, the requirements.
Yeah, people are trying to shoehorn stuff in that really just isn't appropriate.
I mean, like talk to the developers if it didn't go forward. That type of thing.
Yeah, if you had a PRT just to get see what it was. What was the project?
Yeah.
Yeah, we can probably. We definitely have a handful of PRDs in town. We have a
Harold Ave, we have Old Mill Lane, I think.
Mill Street.
Yeah. This one is not developed, this one was adopted last town meeting. There is a few, I think Leaning, I think Leaning Elm is a PRD. Yep, that's a PRD, that's a PRD.
Gazebo Circle.
That's Gazebo Circle, that was municipal land.
And is it,
There's Bay State Road.
Back Bay Court.
Or Back Bay Court, yes. Let's go back.
And then there are those, to John's point, that did not proceed.
Yeah, those might be harder to find information on, but I have a few ideas on how to look at that.
Okay. Good, so.
I mean, most of these were done at around the same time.
Mm-hmm.
I think like the early 90s, mid-90s, and I think they were all represented by the same attorney. So he might have, we can maybe reach out to him and see if he had presented any other PRDs.
Yeah. Yeah. This is definitely a little tricky in figuring how to move forward on this. Just got to do our fact finding and.
Yeah, sometimes you got to look back to see how to move forward.
What was that?
Sometimes you got to look back to see how to.
Yeah, definitely.
I don't see this as a crucial problem that needs to be solved.
I agree.
Something that just, you know, if we have time, we understand that it's.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Just a big chunk of our bylaw right now that we didn't tackle with the first go around, so it seems like a good place to keep moving.
Yeah.
But you're right. Nobody's going to freak out if. We didn't get to this before even April.
Yeah, we said that this was going to be in the past November town meeting timeframe, so.
The only challenge I see is we've got some big hit items that we're going to need to tackle, like signs and parking. It's going to suck up a lot of our time and resources, I would assume.
Signs could be a short conversation.
You know what? That's right.
We're going to be getting some more information, but
yeah, send all the link to the webinar for
can we put aside like a half hour on an upcoming agenda to just understand, have somebody present to us what's changed? And
it sounds like I didn't hear that webinar, but I had an associate that did the APA webinar, and they said that the presentation was not helpful, and then so we did some digging to try and understand it, and it sounded to me like people are really still digesting and trying to do analysis on what's it really mean. So it'd be great if we had some counsel on that.
Yeah.
But to your point, it sounds like it's still a moving target at the moment,
right,
on what that whole Supreme Court decision means.
But Gene, based on your comment that it could be a short discussion, what is your understanding of the impact to our bylaw?
Town council has been extremely cautious about anything we do. And he's, I haven't seen the webinar yet. We were going to watch that next week and get some more information, but he's all like, put the brakes on it till
someone
we really know.
Someone else tests the,
yes.
Someone else tests,
right,
what it all means.
Okay.
Is.
Yeah.
All right.
So we're still learning what that looks like, so I wouldn't feel pressured to do anything.
Parking, on the other hand.
Yeah, we did have a meeting a couple Thursdays ago with in-house staff to talk about parking, that we've recirculated the parking study. I actually got back in touch with Jason Scribner from Nelson Nygaard, who wrote the parking study. And he's happy to come and give us some free advice, which is always interesting. And I think with parking, what I walked away from our staff meeting on it was, we still don't really know what the impacts are of the full development, certainly with the downtown.
Hmm.
And so it's hard to think about policy making and zoning. We really don't know, again, where we're at, what the impacts are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's so much parking downtown.
Well, there's also
a sea of asphalt.
It's a moving target in terms of the requirement.
Yeah.
Because we've got the old post office, we've got Walgreens, we've got some number of underutilized both parking areas and buildings.
Yeah.
The peak occupancy and peak demand isn't there yet.
And the fact that we have so many privately owned parking areas that are essentially off limits and underutilized,
yeah,
I think is a real opportunity to dig into that and see if we can leverage those areas, perhaps with the town as the lead. And I know that probably mentioned it before, in Lexington, the town actually entered into agreements with, say, for example, banks, and said, we will accept the liability if you would be willing to sign a lease with us, we'll lease the parking.
Mm-hmm.
And then that, because I think it's really about the liability.
Yeah.
And there's probably a million other ways to diffuse that rather than require more parking.
Mm-hmm.
And essentially that's what happens now anyway.
You park in bank parking lot, and no one cares. At least you just can't formalize it.
You can't formalize it, right.
All right, well, we'll keep moving forward on PRD and PUD. Maybe schedule, I don't know, maybe not for the next meeting, but for the meeting following. People can review this over the next month. Think through how they would like it, you know, their preferences, what they like, what they don't like. We can start to kind of compile that list, compare notes, and not, obviously not worry about it for, we're not going to worry about it for November. We can target April, but if we are not feeling comfortable, we don't have to rush.
Yeah. No sooner than April.
Yeah. And then signs and parking, we'll just, we don't have to really worry about it.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, anybody have any comments from the public on any of this? All right. Good. Next up on our agenda, update on the Tennessee Gas Line Northeast Energy Direct Project. So, Jesse, is this something that you'll be...
Yeah, so we got
updating us on.
Yeah, we got notice from FERC that on their intent to file the environmental impact statement. So they actually haven't filed it at this point. They gave us some limited information. I actually had to ask them for some better maps just because this is actually what they gave us.
Hmm.
At a scale that you really can't tell. So when we last looked at this, I know that they have submitted information to us before, and it's still in the same location as it was, and it actually follows an existing utility corridor that we have in that corner. There's an existing gas line already, and there actually is a overhead utility in that area. So this is the location where proposed inletting is just up in this corner.
partially within the Cedar Swamp land and partially within the...
Camp Curtis Hill, yeah. I mean, it's basically no big deal.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, at this point, it's, we don't really have, I mean, it's going to go through Concom and their process. But at this point, I mean, there's, we don't have, it's not really a high developed area. I mean, it's...
I do think that I heard, did I read, did you guys hear this or read this? One town, I think maybe Tewksbury, is adamantly opposed to their rooting through town. But because it goes, I don't know, through a highly developed area.
I would tell you that they're not playing nice with the township.
So, but that's exactly not what we have here.
Exactly.
Yeah, pretty fortunate.
So I'm assuming that when we do get the, their filing of the actual EIS, you know, we can take another look at it then. But at this point, I don't, if the CPDC feels it's necessary to send comments back, but it's going to go through, yeah, it's going to go through Concom and their process.
Yeah, who can rely on their expertise?
Right.
Okay. They still had John as the chairman. I'm not sure how that.
What's that?
They still have you as the chairman in the files.
Has it been 6 years?
I don't know.
Well.
So that's that.
That's easy.
Yeah.
Holy smokes. Get out of here by 9 o'clock.
let's see. So, Biltmore, Maine sent in their sign application for their permit with the building inspector, and they made a change, a minor change, but I wanted to run it by the board, possibly for some administrative review. So if you recall, we wanted them to revise the sign to have the halo illumination be with the B and the M,
mm-hmm.
which they proposed, but then they're also showing some halo around the cabinet itself. So when I spoke with the designer, the concern was that the B&M would not reach far enough to sort of illuminate the other graphics in the sign. So they added a string of LEDs that are going to be sort of within the cabinet. But there's going to be some space between the aluminum cabinet and the face of the sign, and they're going to be tucked in underneath that. He doesn't have a detail on how... that's going to look, if there's going to be a chance that you can actually see the LED fixture. I told him that that's usually the concern, is actually seeing the bulb itself. But he said that there will likely be a way to address that. So I wanted to bring it to the board to see if this sort of lighting concept was okay, and work with him sort of through that concern of seeing the actual light source.
Yeah, I mean, I know from a straight technology point of view that you don't have to, you can do what they want without the light, the LED itself being visible. Whether they will do that is the question.
Yeah.
So
the concern, you know, I think, you know, when you're I don't think you're going to be able to see it direct on, but if there's no sort of lip that sort of meets the face of the sign and the aluminum cabinet itself, when you walk up to it, you probably be able to look up and see sort of the upper string of LED, which from driving or from a distance, you probably wouldn't be able to see it.
Right.
Because you tucked in.
Where's Nick when you need him? Can you run it by Nick? He might have some creative ideas.
If the board is comfortable with this
concept, like the lighting, having the halo illumination in addition to the B&M around the circle. You know, you can
I mean, to a certain extent, it's the visual equivalent of putting a gooseneck and pointing it at the sign. I mean, it just happens to be that the light source is in the rim. And as long as it's concealed, then, you know, I think it's probably, it's a good clean way of throwing some more lumens onto the sign.
Yeah. I get what they're trying to do. I guess it's a reasonable solution.
Well, it's our standard guideline. You know,
yeah.
We don't want the light source element to be, casually visible.
Mm-hmm.
If they can do that, then.
Well, the question is, how do we know that before it goes up?
Right.
And you really don't. I mean, in a lot of signs, though. Here's the thing, it's in a lot of signs. If you look at it from the wrong angle, you see the light source. That's what we had the whole discussion about Chili's.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
If you look at that sign that's going in the wrong angle, you're going to see the light source. It's going to,
mm-hmm.
only, you probably need to be standing in the exact right place, but you're going to see the light source. I think that's the case with a lot of lights. I mean, it's not a great example, but you could certainly do that with the one up on South Main Street that changed their name recently.
Fusilli's?
Sam's Bistro.
Right.
Even when they put it in there the right way, you could still see the light source. I guess I'm not all that concerned about.
Yeah.
The light source on the sign.
But so the question to us is, are we comfortable giving you guys the authority to work with them and ultimately approve the redesign? Yeah.
That's up to you guys. Yeah.
Yeah.
Of course. Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And I can throw this by Nick. He might have some recommendations for concealment.
Mm-hmm.
Seek his feedback.
Well, I mean, as you say, if there's a little, you know, if there's just a little lip on the band around the sign, I mean, it doesn't take much. I've got one of those Home Depot strips of LED lighting, the under cabinet lighting, and they're wonderful small things that throw a lot of light.
Right.
And take, you know, very little shielding to put them. Make it indirect.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How are they coming?
Good. They've filed for their building permit, so they're working out some details with that application. So they want to get started soon.
It's been primarily what's been all demolition up to now.
I don't know what. I don't think they've been doing actual work. We haven't issued any permits. They might have been doing like some non-permitted work, like cosmetic stuff.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, they've been doing something, just not the major bulk of the work yet.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah. The other thing that came in today, it's actually in your desk packets. Ray has been working with DEP. On the Aquifer Protection District. So DEP sent some comments.
Oh boy.
And Ray has provided his comments, his responses to their comments, and that is on in your packets just before the minutes.
They're going back and forth on the definition. The bottom of the page, comments 3 and 4.
Yeah. So is this at a point where we need to weigh in, or?
So, yeah, I know throwing this at you, like, to read tonight is going to be, we really don't want to do that, but what we want to do is have you guys take a look at it, and see how you feel about Ray's comments, sort of taking them or leaving them, and then what we would eventually want to do is sort of go back to EPP for one final review before probably making a recommendation to town meeting.
And again, where the warrant closes a little bit early this year, we probably want to schedule that in August, the next meeting in August.
So I'm thinking that, take a review at it, we'll have it on the agenda for the 10th.
Yep.
And we can discuss it as an agenda item, talk through it, and then at that point, we may be able to make a recommendation at that point if the board was comfortable with it, or sending it back to DEP and then back for final recommendation. I mean, some of these comments seem pretty minor.
Yeah.
I think the biggest one is sort of rearranging the liquid hazardous materials, and Ray made a suggestion to sort of combine them to make it easier. Modify one, but sort of combine it with the other.
So right now, it sits with DEP. Ray and his team have provided their responses back.
Well, DEP's provided their comments. Ray is saying to us, to the CPDC, saying, here are DEP's comments, are my recommendations for to address their comments.
He has not sent those to DEP.
I think they might have had some back and forth, but I don't know if they've sent these back. I just got this today. I don't think they've seen them because the gentleman they've been working with is not in the office at the moment from DEP.
Honestly, I feel like Ray's been very involved in this, and he's clear on what our goals are, our intent is. I trust him.
It's hard. I'm having a hard time with this section, you know, the comments 3 and 4, and putting it into the context of what I recall the rest of it is. So I think I trust, like you said, I trust Ray that he understands what our issues were. I mean, it was more about making sure that we aren't, having restrictions in definition, in the definition of what an underground storage tank is, defining it as what it isn't.
Yeah, this is just making it more affirmative in the permitted uses versus prohibited.
Right. And you feel this is pretty minor?
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't recommend making any recommendations tonight just because it wasn't on the agenda. But we can certainly put it on for the 10th, and I think we'll probably be able, you know, at that point, I can touch base with Ray and see if he's thrown this back to DEP. Considering that you guys seem pretty comfortable with this, we can, you know, I can say, Ray, they seem pretty comfortable. Why don't you run it back to DEP with these comments?
Totally, yeah.
And see what they say. At that point, the CPDC would probably be able to make their recommendation with these comments.
Mm-hmm. So you're okay. So the 10th, you're suggesting we have this as an agenda topic.
Correct.
But not take a vote.
You could probably take a vote.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, what I'm saying is, if Ray has not sort of given these responses to DEP, he should.
Mm-hmm.
Because it sounds like tonight, you know, quick. Look, it sounds like this is sort of the direction that you agree with, Ray.
Yep.
Yeah.
See if DEP agrees with it, and if they have any other rebuttals, we can at least address those on the 10th.
I would have no problem Ray sending this off to
Okay.
To be these responses.
Sure.
I agree.
And see where they land.
Right. Yeah, you don't always know what you're going to get, but let's see what they say.
Yep.
Okay. And then we'll put it on for the.
I mean, I'll still take this home and review it, and I can't imagine I have any issues.
Right.
That's good. Seems like what we anticipated when we had the public hearing is, and how we decided to handle it is actually working out, so that's good.
Yeah.
Good, what else?
That's really it from last things that came in. Still haven't heard from the state on the 40Bs. Nothing's come in.
Are they required to respond within any sort of time period?
I don't think so.
Oh.
Did everyone retire in that office?
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, I checked in with Ray to see if we, you know, should we be doing something? Should we be preparing? Should we be? He's like, Gene, there's really nothing you can do at this point.
Mm-hmm.
You have no control over it. And there's nothing to get ready for.
Yep, all right. Post office? Anything?
I haven't heard anything.
Rumblings? Nothing concrete.
Yeah.
The Quiznos may have a tenant.
Cool, good.
They're working through that. Another restaurant, deli.
Okay.
Tenant. I think the size falls under the CPDC thresholds, and since it's the same use,
right.
No CPDC review. Except for the sign. He actually may come in with sort of a different sign. That building has a master signage plan,
mm-hmm.
And he wants to do something a little bit different. He's got some unique ideas, and so we'll probably see that at some point. Probably, I think he's aiming for the 24th.
Okay.
Progress on Pizza World property?
He was in today speaking with Glenn, sort of identifying building
next
permit stuff.
Yeah.
He still has to close out the site, so he's working on that. He expects that to be done soon.
Close out meaning
get that
hazardous material.
The response action outcome. So he thinks he's close to getting that. They just submitted another monitoring report. He thinks that's the last one. So he's working on that.
Is Perfecto's going to have some siding sometime soon? Or
it's a big building, huh?
It is a big
building. It is big. It's bigger than I expected it to be.
Yeah.
I mean,
better looking than a burned out tuck shop, but it's huge.
The Economic Development Action Plan, so that's moving along. MAPC has been doing sort of the back work, actually putting the plan together. So we will actually have a document in draft form in September, right?
Yep.
And then the form is on the 23rd, so everybody's welcome to attend.
Mm-hmm.
That it's going to be at RMLD this time.
Okay.
So that's moving along.
We had the ribbon cutting for the recycle bin in the CVS parking lot, and people were very excited about that and very appreciative, and very big thank yous to CPDC and the Board of Selectmen, and it was a very festive occasion.
Good. Any known use, any updates, or I don't know. Is it being used yet?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah?
Oh, yes.
Good.
Yep.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah, right before we did the ribbon cutting, there was one of the local businesses came over with pizza boxes and
deposited them in the container. So that gave me great joy to see that.
Great joy.
And then we are working on the transformation of the planted island in front of Sims Jewelers. The seating wall is in.
Oh, yeah.
Good.
And there'll be stamped concrete. This is one of those downtown islands when they did the streetscape. Mm. They had the three trees that we had heard from businesses, you know, they love the island, they love the greenery, but the trees were blocking business. So we removed the middle tree and came up with a new design for making it more of a passive recreation area with seating.
Yeah.
So we carved out a portion of it, scooped out the fill, and put in a double-sided seating wall.
Cool.
And then the surface treatment will be stamped concrete. That's next. And the goal is to get that ready before the Fall Street Fair.
Good.
The next meeting agenda, we are going to try and have ready for the board some information on the older subdivisions that we would like to take to town meeting for roadway acceptance. So there's quite a few older subdivisions that roadways were never accepted or was never finished. So there may be some action that CPDC actually has to take because there may not have been a sort of a final certificate of completion issued. And generally, CPDC makes makes a recommendation for street acceptance. So there's a handful of streets that we're looking at, and hopefully we'll have a pretty clear picture as to where we stand on some of those.
Okay, when's?
Is there?
What's the meeting schedule?
On August. That would be August 10th.
Okay. I will not be around.
Okay.
I'll be out of town.
Okay.
Just FYI.
Anybody else foresee any absences?
Nope.
Is there a criteria that goes along with street acceptance?
Yes. It's actually pretty thorough. But the CPDC can waive minor items, so if, you know, a catch basin wasn't set or something really minor, you can waive that as a criteria, because essentially everything needs to be complete. The town engineer has to make a recommendation that everything's been installed and in accordance with the plan and all these things, but some of these are so old that the developer's gone. There's no bond money, or if we're showing bond money, we may not know where it is. You know, so some of these things we may sort of have to take recommendation from the town engineer that it's minor enough to address. If there is bond money, some of them, there is bond money, and we actually may be able to recover some of that,
right,
then the recommendation would be to take it to fulfill these outstanding items.
But all that's going to come along with whatever the agenda is.
Will the town engineer be here? Does he need to be here?
I would like him to be here, yes.
Okay, cool.
So we have a staff meeting this week. We've been meeting on this quite a bit to sort of doing a lot of research. Our intern has been in the town clerk's office, been in the treasurer's office, all over town hall doing a lot of research and working with the engineers to find out the status of these roads. And some information we have and some we don't, and some roads we even have record that they were accepted already, but the street acceptance plan was never approved after that. So, you know, things like that, where do we stand? So we'll be working with council as well.
You should have the intern come and present to us. That'd be a good opportunity for
that would be intense.
Yeah. Hey. Throw him or her in the fire.
She could certainly come. She's been doing all the research. It might be
yeah, maybe not present, but I'd just think about,
her,
you know. Professional development.
Do we have this?
Yeah, no, she's been very helpful.
She's taking a night class this summer too, so it's part of the issue.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, just see. It'd be good for her, I think.
Yeah.
So, so if we have everything in line, we'll have it on for the 10th, because we'll need to sort of know what roads can move forward.
Right.
And which ones can be included on the warrant. I mean, if they're included on the warrant, they need to fall back for whatever reason could, but we really want to have that idea of what can move forward.
Okay.
Okay.
So.
So we have some minutes?
We've got some minutes. Let's knock these out. And we'll start with the 29th. I had a couple of minor comments. Under section 1.0, Ms. Wilson presented the proposed changes, noting the goal is to keep the, I think purpose should be capitalized. And then as far as the votes go, I think it should be 3-0-1, since John, I think you abstained. Because you were a little late.
Were you here for that?
No, I was not here for that.
Did you?
No, I didn't even. I walked in right as Nick was reading the.
Okay.
Notice.
Oh, okay. Okay. So 3-0-0 is
yeah.
Is right. Okay. Gotcha. And then under review draft language for telecommunications bylaw, it's the third line up from the bottom. So it was agreed to note that the SBGA will be CPDC. And then the CPDC also remove agree. Say the CPDC also wants to spell out and then lastly go to the end the fourth paragraph up. Mr. Miaris commented that most of the public concerns are health-related. The next section, I didn't understand what was being said, but below the CPDC's authority to use that as criteria for review.
The law limits the CPDC.
Okay.
I would almost say, but federal law.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Any other comments on the 29th?
CPDC approved the minutes for the meeting of 29 June 2015 as amended.
Check.
All those in favor? All right.
Next we've got the 13th. My first it's a question. Did we agree to change the title of the communication structures bylaw to be personal wireless services zoning bylaw or just wireless zoning services?
I think it was personal.
Is it personal?
I think
yeah.
It was personal. And then right before that, there's an extra at. Throughout, it had the vote counts being 4-0-0. I think everyone was there, right? So I think it should be 5-0-0.
And then under 6 Linden Street, the word venial? Is that right? Is that the word? Isn't that kind of sin or something?
Yeah.
Venial? Right here? Is that mortal and venial sins?
Vinyl, maybe?
Oh.
The wall of the blade signs, vinyl.
Vinyl?
Yeah, because I think that's what it's made of.
Okay.
Right.
All right.
Yes. It would be unusual to have an existing sign that's venial.
Yeah. I'm reading, like I said. Back to my days in religion class. Anyone else have any comments?
Nope.
All right.
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of July 13th, 2015, as amended.
Second.
All those in favor? All right. Thank you. Anything else tonight?
Move to adjourn.
There you go.
Second.
All those in favor? All right. Thanks, folks.